Okay, so today we'll see something. First, we'll look at the evaluation of geopotential thickness from sonde data, that means radio sonde data. What is radio sonde? Means a balloon, you send some instrument, okay, then it'll go up into the atmosphere. Then it will record the temperature. What will it record? Temperature. It will also record the humidity. Of course, it may go horizontally for some distance, but we do not worry. We say that within limits, it represents the same station. Okay. How do we calculate the geopotential thickness? Because once you have the geopotential thickness, you can process and do other things. How will you calculate the geopotential thickness from sonde data? But now we have very powerful satellites available, okay. So they can find out what is the radiation emerging at the top of the satellite in various channels, whether it is in infrared or microwave or visible. From that they can calculate, and actually you can work out the geopotential thickness directly. Before satellites came into existence, the sonde data was the only thing which is available. So let us look at the typical, it will be like this. So it is like this, TV and the ln P, okay. What is the formula for the geopotential thickness? Z2 minus Z1 RD TV bar, no? TV bar by G0 ln, okay. Now what we are saying is, you sent a balloon into the atmosphere, radio sonde instrument, balloon with instruments. So you are measuring the temperature with height, or temperature, pressure and omega, right. So with that omega you are calculating, you can get the straight away the partial pressure of water vapor. So TV equal to T by correct. So whenever you are recording the temperature and the humidity, you are able to get the TV also. So you will be able to plot, so across the atmosphere you will be able to generate this plot of virtual temperature versus what is that, ln of pressure. What do we want? Z2 minus Z1 is what we want. RD is no problem, G0 is no problem, P1 P2 measured. But you cannot solve this equation unless you get TV bar, okay. TV bar is not just TV 1 plus TV 2 by 2 or something, okay. So what we normally do is, let us take one particular station A, so this is ln P1, okay. So let us say this is A, so this is B, so this is ln P2. Okay. So you take a scale like this, you keep moving like this till you hit a point where this is equal to this. Got it? Okay. That is TV bar. Did you understand? It is a very crude way of getting TV bar. Now with calculator and this thing, all that is not required. But if you just add the sounding data, this is what you would have done. I come again. So you will get this raw data from your radio sonde. How do you get this? From the sonde data, you get temperature, you get pressure and relative humidity. Relative humidity can be converted to partial pressure of water vapor. You know this equation for virtual temperature. You can calculate virtual temperature with every pressure level, okay. Plot this. Let us take, so I can make this as C, D, E. So let us consider two levels. P1 and P2 or ln P1 and ln P2. So this point is A, this point is B. So I know these two levels. I am interested in calculating the average temperature, average virtual temperature, because my original intent or idea is to calculate the geopotential thickness. So this is what I want, Z2 minus Z1. Okay. So this is 287 that is known to us. This G0 I know, ln P1, P2 I know. So I need to get TV bar. So I plot this, then as I told you, so I will take a scale and move this horizontally till such time I get CE equal to ED. When it cuts the vertical, draw it down, pull it down, and what you get is now TV bar. Now this TV bar, you substitute into this equation, you can calculate the geopotential thickness. Now it appears very easy. Now with the remote sensing, you can directly do it. Okay? All right. So it is possible for me to give you some sounding data in the exam, ask you to plot, give a graph sheet, semi-log or log-log or something. Okay? You plot it and I may ask you to find the geopotential thickness. Okay. Otherwise, is there a way of calculating your average virtual temperature? You have to get the integral. Okay. So instead of getting the integral, we are doing a graphical or visual method of getting the geopotential thickness. Is it okay? Now, before we get on to the first law of thermodynamics, we need to study a concept on reduction of pressure to sea level. Now tell me, why is this required? Sir, always we reduce it to sea level pressure, sir. What is the big deal? What are we talking about? So I'll give you a clue. We are talking about something, some regions which are special. Which regions? When can the surface pressure itself change? Which kind of region? In mountainous regions, somewhere you'll have 0 meters, somewhere you'll have 100 meters, somewhere you'll have 500 meters, somewhere you'll have 400 meters. In hilly region, in mountainous regions, the surface pressure alone will, surface pressure itself will change. Then if you're doing all your thermodynamic calculations and attribute your weather or changes to some other thing, you'll make a mistake because your 0 itself is not correct. Okay, so this is something important in mountainous regions. The spelling is correct, mountainous. You can check it with Google. What is the goal? The goal is to remove the effect of elevation. So now we need to know how the pressure decreases with height for the first few 100 meters. Let us go back for all this, we have to go back to the hypsometric equation. So what we are doing is we are just playing with the hypsometric equation, various forms, how it can be used and so on. Okay. Before we get on to the first law of thermodynamics. So Zg. Zg is ground, Z0 is sea level. Sea level, what is Z0? Value. Okay. But Zg is not, that is a simple matter. Zg is not 0. Okay. Now, So we can put P naught e to the power of, please check whether it is plus, is it okay? All right, now P naught is more than PG, right? So 1, we will start with 1 in today's class. All right, so P naught equal to PG into I will erase this. Now, if Zg by H is much less than 1, when will this happen? What is the value of H? 8 kilometers, okay. H is about, so when will Zg by H be much much smaller than 1? Okay, so Zg a few hundred meters, 0 to a few hundred meters. Okay. Then so this is 5. P naught. How do you expand e to the power of Zg by H? When for small expansion, that is it, correct, 1 plus, you can see, you can check it if you want, e to the power of 0.1 or something, okay. So therefore, six, eh? So this is 6. Okay, did we do it right? Now, just get an estimate of that. So let's say PG is about 1000 HPa. P naught, so P naught minus PG is 8. So what is that? Okay, so P naught minus PG by PG, if Zg is 100 meters, this will be 12.5. Okay, if PG is 1000, so it will be so many hectopascal and all that. So you will get an idea of, So can we make a statement that, in other words, for altitudes up to a few hundred meters above or below sea level, pressure decreases by 1 hpa for every 8 meters. The pressure decreases by 1 hpa for every 8 meters. This is a rule of thumb. All right? Okay. So enough of the hypsometric equation. What is the hypsometric equation all about? The hypsometric equation is also known as the thickness equation, which relates the geopotential thickness to the gas constants, the average virtual temperature, and the natural log of the ratio of the pressures. So it is a very important relationship where you can seamlessly go from ideal gas equation to hydrostatic equation to geopotential thickness. All these are combined. Okay. Now let's get on to interesting part, namely the first law of thermodynamics. Any doubts so far? The first law of thermodynamics, one of the cornerstones of thermodynamics, it gave the relationship between heat and work. Okay, it gave the, previously the relationship between heat and work was not known, largely because heat was not used to produce work. So the first law of thermodynamics was necessary because people wanted mechanical power. For what? People wanted mechanical power for removing water. Why remove water? Because they wanted to go after coal. Why did they want to go after coal? Because they wanted to burn. Okay, they wanted to get they wanted a source of heat. What were they doing before? They were using wood. Okay, they were using wood and trying to get charcoal from wood, and they were using charcoal. Okay, why not continue to use the wood? Now, what did the first law of thermodynamics say? For a cycle, the cyclic integral of heat is equal to the cyclic integral of work. Both heat and work are path functions. Therefore, you have to put this delta. They cannot be represented by never. Okay, if you have learnt it, please take an eraser and erase it from your brain. Okay, as IIT students, if you put dq or dw, immediately the professor's blood pressure will shoot up. Okay. All right, should be del q and del w. Okay, cycle. What is a cycle? You take something from 1 to 2, you bring it back from 2 to 1. Okay? This is A, this is B. So a cycle will consist of at least 2 processes. Many people would be tempted to say 3 processes, but 2 processes are enough. Okay? You take it from 1 to 2 and bring it back from 2 to 1. The total heat, the algebraic sum of all the heat interactions, which can be very honorably replaced by an integral. So if there are so many infinite number of interactions, the summation can be replaced by an integral. So the algebraic sum or the integral of the heat interactions will be equal to the integral of the work interactions. But life is not always about a cycle. What about for a non-cyclic process? Q minus W equal to delta E, where Q is the algebraic sum of all the heat interactions, W is the algebraic sum of all the work interactions, and delta E is the change in energy. So E is a property of the system. A system is a given mass of something, consideration, it can be steam, air or whatever, which can have work and heat interactions, but there can't be any exchanges of mass. If you want to have exchanges of mass also, then you call it as a control volume, okay. So the first law for a non-cyclic process relates the Q and W, and it says that Q minus W must be equal to delta E. It never says that Q minus U equal to E. So it is only the changes in the energy level which are very important. So you can decide the datum as you please. The datum is not very important. We are looking at only changes in the E, okay. Then what is this change in energy? This change in energy can be change of many things. Change in internal energy plus change in potential energy plus change in kinetic energy plus capillarity, surface tension, electrical, all those things, plus, 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 okay. For a pure substance, where only there is only one displacement work and all the other things are negligible, delta E can be approximated to be delta U. I am not saying E equal to U. But delta E can be approximated to be delta U, okay. So if this is the story, Q minus W . So this is change in internal energy. Internal energy is that mode of energy which can be directly influenced by heat transfer. It is usually accompanied by a temperature change, but internal energy can also take place, internal energy change can also take place without a temperature change, as in the case of phase change process, melting or solidification or evaporation, okay. All this is not new to you, all this is known to you, we teach it in ME 110, ME 1100 in thermodynamics. In engineering thermodynamics, displacement work is very important. What is this displacement work? Consider a cylinder and piston arrangement. Okay. System of mass M, okay. So you got air, combustion gases, whatever you want, okay. This is your piston. So the piston is moving. Either you are compressing or it has got high pressure, it is moving in the other direction, okay. So when force moves by a distance, there is work, okay. dW is FdX. You want to keep it as dW or W? Okay. What is the force here? Pressure into area. So it's a PDV work. PD. Okay, let's stick to the numbers now. 5. Okay, so Q equal to for a pure substance, you can define what is called the specific heat at constant volume, which is nothing but PdV plus so if you want you can so you can put it in various forms. Okay, then when dV equal to 0, that is you are heating or cooling something by holding on to the volume, this will become 0, then CV will become this is a stupid high school definition of specific heat, the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 kg of water from 14 degree centigrade to 15 degree centigrade. Why is it a stupid definition? Because heat is a path function. Heat is not a property of the system. It takes place only when interaction, it happens only during an interaction. But specific heat is a property of the system. Temperature is a property of the system. It is conceptually incorrect to define a specific heat based on heat. Therefore, in thermodynamics, we are very clear that we do not use this physics definition which has been endlessly repeated by physics professors, all by your physics teachers. The CV is the partial derivative of the internal energy with respect to the temperature when V is constant. This is a more acceptable definition because all the quantities on the left hand side and right hand side, both numerator, denominator, what have you, they are all properties of the system. Okay, shall we proceed? Okay, now we can define a new another new quantity called enthalpy can be defined. Please note that when I put small h, I put small v, small v specific volume. Otherwise, I have to put correct 13 and 14. So let us work on this. So this D, we can also define a specific heat at, so this is specific heat at constant volume. Okay, you can also define a specific heat at constant pressure. Cp equal to okay. Now, please do a small exercise. Establish the relationship between Cp and Cv for an ideal gas. Okay. I repeat, please do a small exercise. Establish the relationship between Cp and Cv for an ideal gas. Please do it. I will give you some time and then I will start doing it on the board. So just expand DH is, I hope you know where to start from. Then at constant pressure. At constant pressure, what happens? At constant pressure, now, please help me. PV equal to? Very good. Now, for an ideal gas, so we are on equation 23, huh? What do you get from that? PdV equal to? When is this valid? Constant pressure, very good. This is called the Mayer's relation. For air, R is 287, Cp is 1005. Therefore, please calculate the value of Cv. 700 and something, correct? Sometimes it is 717 also, right? It's okay. For monatomic molecules, Cp by Cv is 5/3, isn't it? Correct? Let me check. Yeah, Cp by Cv is 5/3. For diatomic, 7/5, correct? 7/5. Air is predominantly diatomic, isn't it? So, we will check that. Calling from memory. So, you are able to see the concordance. Okay. This can be theoretically derived, that 5/3, and from kinetic theory of gases, you must have done somewhere. All right. So, this moist air we have not considered, mostly ideal gas, dry air and all that. Okay. Now, we have to look at some interesting, we have to now look at some adiabatic processes. Adiabatic processes are very important in the atmosphere. Okay. So, let us look at the adiabatic process. So, we covered a lot of ground today, that is good. An adiabatic process is one in which dQ equal to 0. An isothermal process dT equal to 0. Temperature is the same, is a very low level. You say dT equal to 0. Okay. Now I am going to ask you a question. I draw a pressure volume diagram. It is called a state diagram in thermodynamics. Okay. V1, V2. I have an isothermal process. 1 to 2. I want to use an adiabatic process. Okay. Please give me a scientific answer as to this A. Okay. I'll mark the options. So, if the isothermal is from 1 to 2 for reaching the same volume, will an adiabatic process follow 1, 2 double dash or 1, 2 dash? In simple English, is the adiabat steeper than the isotherm or the isotherm is steeper than the adiabat? Please prove it mathematically. Please prove it from first principles. It is not, you cannot do it in one step. Please prove it from first principles. I want a long proof. So, which will use repeatedly the first law of thermodynamics. So, first law of thermodynamics is given to you and the definition of isothermal and adiabatic process given to you. The concept of ideal gas is also given to you. Okay? So, please go ahead. Okay, I will write it on the board. Is the adiabat steeper than the isotherm? Is the question clear to you? Okay, let me start. So, for process 1, 2, you want to do process 1, okay. Process, let us say 1, 2 dash. For the process 1, 2 dash, all right. So, dq is 0, let us start with 1. How will you proceed from here? Sorry. PdV plus dU. I messed it up. dW plus dU is equal to PdV plus dU. Some of you may already understand what is the route I am taking. Huh? Mm. So, what? Integrate. Integrate 5. One to two dash, huh? 1 to 2 dash. What is this? Right side, it is compressed or what is the value of this integral? Sign of the integral, negative, why? You are compressing from V1 to V2, okay? So, this is negative. If this is multiplied by negative, T2 dash minus T1 is positive, okay? Therefore, however, for 1, 2, T1 equal to T2, because 1, 2 is a isothermal process. Therefore, okay. Because we are compressing it to the same level. In simple English, the adiabat is steeper than the isothermal. Proved, huh? Is it okay? Okay, therefore, okay, so we will stop here. Any doubts? So we will continue. Is the proof clear? Logical? Okay.